Hi guys, welcome to Captain German Exploring YouTube channel. You know, in our channel we post video about sailing, sailors and whatever about life on the water. Today we post story about man who start his trip as a backpacker and became a sailor on his way. On my point of view, it is a very inspiring video for everybody, not only for me, and we decide to share it with you. Sorry it's a bit windy today, but I hope everything will be fine in terms of sound quality, but in case of some troubles, I'm sorry, it's not my fault, it's a nature. When Malit was 22, he started his trip as a backpacker, crossed half Europe and join a crew on a sailing vessel, little bit on a Canarian island, again cross Atlantic, but he travels not alone, he travels with a powerful protection, strong dog, but very cute. After Central America, South America, finally he found his boat in a lake. So today we post story about Malit and Izia. Are you ready? Let's go. This is 30 feet boat designed by Charlie Morgan 1976, restored by Malit from zero to hero. Hi guys, welcome to Captain German Exploring YouTube channel, and I would like to introduce you Malit. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for inviting us to your perfect boat.
Thank you for your interview.
And by the way, it is a not only cool boat, it is a cool story you promised us to tell.
It's a long story, it's like 6 years, so it's...
Okay,
so my name is Malit. I grew up in France. I'm originally from Sri Lanka. I moved to France when I was 5 years old. And yeah, I grew up mostly in Mulhouse, east side of France. And I went to study at some point in Strasbourg. Until my 22 years old.
I saw that you were studying in an art university.
Yeah, I did like 3 years, but it was fucked up. It's I did it wrong, so at some point I just quit the study. And at that moment was the right moment to take a decision about... Yeah, so I decided at that moment to travel to when I was 22, so it was 2015. And here I am. When I started my project, it was kind of, I wanted to travel far, long time.
But
I didn't know exactly where. No. At that moment, I was like just quitting studying. I had my backpack. I had just a little amount of money that I was making with my friend. Working in a school.
And what did you do?
I like taking care of kids, stuff like this, animation.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Just a little work, you know, like to make money. And yeah, I took my backpack and I just left my house. I say goodbye to my mother. And from
was
the...
Was it difficult?
It was difficult, but yeah, I took it with a different perspective now. But it was emotional.
But 22 is a good age.
It's perfect.
Too.
It's perfect. The time you discover the world and you go.
Responsibility. Yet, like not like loans. You have to take care of a big family of your own to take care of. Like,
but it's quite common for European mostly to have just you know after school, after college, just to travel, and it is quite common.
It's the life.
It is in our country. It's not really common because people normally start to travel when they already have money and job and whatever, but for Europeans it's a most quite common scene when they start to travel in a where did you go as a backpacker?
Well, my project was to go first in Africa, but I start from my home, my house. My start of my travel is when I close the doors of my house, and I just went to the streets. We start to hitchhike with another guy, with another girl. And we all went to central of France, and from there we start a walk with very famous in France. It's called Santiago de Compostela. So we did that trek from Le Puy-en-Velay all the way.
Like the whole one?
Yeah, it's a full.
The full
so
one.
It's like 3,600 kilometers walking with a backpack.
Is it just around?
No, it's a direction actually. From central of France, you have many different ways, but that one starts in Le Puy-en-Velay and the end of all roads go to Santiago de Compostela, with kind of a holy city in Spain, with like on the coast, like a northwest point in Galicia. And so yeah, this is why 3,600 kilometers. No, 1,006.
And how much time does it take?
I have no idea because I didn't have so much money. So sometimes I stop at some place, walk, wash dishes.
Just to have some side,
stop some
side
community.
Money.
I stopped in some community. I didn't rush like most of the people do. I just took my time. I think it took like 4 months to do 1,006. In Santiago de Compostela, I stay in some communities with other people learning construction.
Yes. Sorry.
No problem. And yeah, after that, I after Santiago, I went down.
I just do everything at once. So.
My boat is a mess. There's stuff everywhere growing.
No, it's any boat it like this. It's fine, you know. No, it's fine.
Okay, just now perfect. So it...
stop bothering everybody.
So yeah, after that, Santiago Compostela, I went down all the west coast of Portugal, the only coast actually, all the way through the reef. On the reef, going south, which is called La Rota de Fatima and La Rosa Vicentina. It's like a trek also. Uh-huh. It's beautiful because you have always the sun on your side and you walk on the beach sometimes. It's amazing. And at points,
nice.
At some moment, I found my lovely princess behind you.
It was a...
yes, yeah. It was in Portugal, 6 years ago almost. 2015, 16, I don't know.
Not biting?
She's a bit grumpy sometimes, but she never bites anyone.
It's fine.
You're so angry.
She's not too used to have so many people on the boat.
Yes, she's like, what is going on? Huh?
But she's cool.
Yes, she's
so
very cool.
So I found her when she was like this, like smaller.
Happy.
Like this size.
Yeah. Where did you find her?
It was like a little a farm. There was this farm with a, how you call a house of chicken? Chicken house?
Chicken house.
So,
Casa del Pollo.
Casa del Pollo. Una polleria.
Polleria.
Okay.
Polleria.
So, this was like... this polleria, and there was like 10 puppies inside, and very small. They had maybe 1 month and a half, and kept by a big rooster. Like God, so I was kind of I fell off and I went there.
So you saved her?
No, I didn't. I didn't save her. She was like the woman had these puppies and she just wanted to throw them out. So at that moment I didn't want a dog, but I was just thinking about an idea of a friend to accompany me because traveling is mostly loneliness, I think. Because you meet a lot of people, but you never.
No, it is a temporary friend.
So. At that moment, I just asked innocently the woman, hey, can I take one of the puppies? And she told me like directly, take it all. So at that moment, I was like kind of blocked, you know, like, should I take it or no? How am I fucking gonna do? I don't have any money. I have just my backpack. I'm traveling for I don't know where. Okay, I take the chance or I leave it. And I fucked the night and I, the morning when I saw her, like she was all the puppy like, running everywhere, eating everything, biting everything. And she was the only little peaceful baby, you know, who was just sleeping. And she was completely white and she had like two red lines. And it made me fucked about Japanese masks. It was so... And I just took her. And she wasn't able to walk at that moment. So what I was doing...
Small.
Yeah, she was too small. And at that moment, I was still walking, you know, 30 kilometers every day with a backpack. And... I had to train her to walk before to force her to walk. So I just put her in my pocket and she was like staying in my pocket like this. And we traveled like this for like maybe 2 weeks until I start to make her walk a bit to bit, 5 meters, 10 meters.
So you trained
And at some point she was able to walk 30 kilometers with me side by side. And that was so cool. Sometimes she was
How
even
more. For her, that would be.
Can you imagine? But
she's super strong. She don't look like, but she's a fucking
she
badass.
A little bit like chilling on the boat.
Yeah. Yeah, man, you should see her when she gets angry. It's kind of a show.
Okay.
But maybe she's resting after that your long trip. She was walking a lot. She's tired from that time.
A long time, all South America and everything. We were walking all day, and no, she's cool for her. You know, she have a boat. She stay. She sleep. She's guarding the boat. No fish comes too close to my boat without her permission. So it's so incredible. You can ask her. She can wake up at 3 a.m. to tell you that a sardine goes too close.
Even small fishes?
Tell me again?
Even small fishes also?
Joking, but...
yes, I'm joking as well. Small sardines. Yes. And
so I took her with me and we continued our travel. South of Spain, Cadiz, Gibraltar. Gibraltar, I passed quite a lot of time there. It was super cool to make some money because I was playing music. I had my little ukulele. I wasn't so good, but yeah, people like the show. Also, you know, the guys with a backpack, with a dog sitting on the backpack, and me with a ukulele and playing super bad, you know. But people was happy to see me, so I was happy too. And yeah, at that point, some moments. I meet an Irish Leprechaun. I don't know if you know what's a Leprechaun. It's like a green dwarf from Ireland. It's a traditional island stuff, no?
No.
A Leprechaun is like green, he keeps a treasure.
Ah, Lepicone. Yeah, yes.
No, we know. I meet a
guy. That small one, yeah.
I meet a small Irish man who just walking on the street. He had this big guitar on his back. And I was playing and I had no plan at that moment. I didn't know where to go. And we just had the feeling from far away, and we start to talk, and he say, "Hey, tomorrow I'm going to Canaries Island. I found a boat who's bring me from Gibraltar to Canaries Island." And so, I ask him, "Hey, can I ask you, Captain? Can I ask you, Captain, if I come with you?" And he didn't found any problem, so we went together. We went to the bar where the Captain was, and it was his Captain was what's his name again? Oh shit, they're gonna be angry against me. Yeah, we sympathize. They didn't want me at the start because I had a dog, so there was
nobody come close. Yes.
Your ears like slowly racing.
Sailor don't like dogs. Usually boat owner don't like dogs because they're afraid that they're gonna eat the wood, break stuff, make dirty. So at the start, they really didn't want me to come in the boat. But at some point, I realized it was my only chance to go from here, from Gibraltar, because if not, I would be stuck. So I argue. I never argue like so much. And I try to convince them, but even it was like, you know, bad to force that much, you know. And at some point, Astrid, the wife of the captain, saw the dog and say, "Oh, she's so cute." And I saw it was, I want.
Take it and keep it for all the trip.
Hold it for 1 minute.
Hold it for all the trip.
When she said that, I was so, fuck, I get it. I get it. I got the boat. I never been in a boat before. I'm also very bad with water. I didn't really learn how to swim when I was a kid. And
but was it difficult for you because it's seasick? Definitely.
Yeah. I was fucked for 1 week. I was like vomiting on the boat everywhere. The dog was better than me. No, seriously.
So
the dog
was a weak point for this trip.
Yeah. I was trying to help as maximum as possible, but I think three quarters of the time I was just sleeping on the side. And the first thing I learned from on the boat was like how to make knots. You know, like the basic knot. I didn't know how to.
Like a bow line or something.
The first thing that my captain teach me was knots. And after that, little by little,
and it's
when I was not vomiting,
you just make a first knot and do like.
Yeah, exactly. Sometimes you just vomit on the knot.
The worst, actually, when you look into something.
Yeah. And yeah, they really didn't like dog, but after the trip, when we arrived in Canary, they were so happy with Izia that they told me, finally, we thought maybe we're gonna get a dog too. And Izia was super cool. Izia was like amazing, and they really like her. They took a lot of photos of her. And
of course, she's such a sweet face.
Even I have her photo on Instagram.
Yes.
Yeah, because I saw
her
in a bar.
When I was in Ukraine, look at this dog. I'm like, yes.
How much time did you spend in the Canarian Islands?
I spent a few months because I was like traveling to different islands, checking.
Where did you come first in which island?
Isla. So yeah, that was the first island. At some point, I was just hitchhiking all the way through. I wanted to go to see what I can find.
How did you change islands?
I cheat the ferry.
Okay.
I don't have so much money, so I just pass, you know, like you pass in the buses in France. You just go hiding
in the ferry, like they don't control your tickets. I was with another guy at that moment, and we both didn't have money, so I was still with this Irish guy. And so, yeah, we was just hiding in the ferry to try to pass.
Crazy hitchhikers, look at that one. But nice, I mean, it's such a cool young people story, yeah. You know.
I think even if they found us, they wouldn't make us too much problem, because they see we are two young guys with backpack with a dog.
With a dog, you
just talking about. Like, oh, okay, so, yeah, you can stay.
Keep this one. For a few seconds.
Like this cat from Shrek, you know? Eye power.
So at some point, yeah, I arrived to Las Palmas de Gran Canaria, and there I spent quite a lot of time. I lived like maybe 3 months in a squat, like a very famous squat, La Bicicleta, it's called. It's like a big building, 5 floors, a lot of people from everywhere in the world who live together.
Yeah,
they don't pay rent, it's like a squat, you know?
Culture,
was a lot of mix of everything, a lot of bad things also, but... Anyway, I keep the good memories of that place. Mm-hmm. We was making party, inviting people for food, collective food. Mm-hmm. We were making like downstairs diving a lot. In Canaries, it's amazing how you can get so much food for free.
And, just hunting?
Huh?
Just like underwater hunting?
No. Downstairs diving. It's like a very kind of cultural thing in the street world. It's very easy to find like what supermarket leftover. We were like 50 people in the squat, and every night, every 3 days.
You have the addresses and the timing, probably something like it's the special organized already.
Yeah, it have a kind of organization. Every 3 days, we were going to the supermarket with four trolling, and we were come back with like a amount of food, but like clean, super clean food, and it was amazing because we can feed all the building, and we can feed all the people around. So
this is such a best way to recycle and to
because it is just on the limit sometimes, like, you know, next day expire it. And
after Canaria,
so there in Las Palmas de Gran Canaria, I found the boats to cross Atlantic.
It's the same, like a backpacker.
No, as a backpacker, I was backpacker. I went to the ports. Pretty good way for travelers, backpackers to go boat stopping. That you go to the marina, you just talk with the captain, or you go to the nights at the bar with all the captain. You wait that they are drunk, and you talk to them. Hey, what's going? We go. We try to show you your best smile, and it's.
And for captains, and make friends. Very reasonable to have somebody to
crew.
Help you out.
Yeah.
To... Want to see something fun? Try to get the beer. Is that you garde la bière? Tu laisses personne toucher.
Okay, I understand.
Nice. Bon, stop. Easy, calme-toi. Easy, stop. Allez, c'est bon. Allez, assieds-toi, ma belle, d'accord? Tu t'énerves un peu trop, là.
It works.
It works.
It works with the boat, also, if somebody comes to my boat, and if I'm not here, she's skipping like crazy.
We see.
We believe you. We saw, we believe.
It was us.
She looked cute on this, but she's
but can you
latest client.
For her whole hard life, you know, because somebody wants to come to your territory, and for her it's like crazy.
You know how does she learn that? Actually, it's because I had a backpack before, you know, backpacking.
Yeah.
And sometimes I was just leaving my bag on the floor, and the dog was staying close of it. And if anybody want to come too close of my backpack, touch the backpack, she would just eat them, you know. So it was so cool for me, because I know that even if she don't attack, she can make so much noise that I know she's gonna just wake up me, or if I'm sleeping in the tent, if somebody come too close of the tent, she just wake up me, and it's such a comfort, you know. I can barely sleep with taking good rest, because sometimes I sleep in a very dangerous place in the middle of the city, stuff like this, and it's a good advantage to have her.
Okay, and you cross Atlantic?
Yes, I found a catamaran. A French catamaran, with Michel, and his second first mate. And I asked them if I can go with them. And it worked, they took me, because the guys was, before it was like, it was in the military and training dogs. So he really loved dogs.
And
he
nice.
Took us on the boat to cross Atlantic because of me, but because of his, mostly. So it's a fun story, because, you know, when I arrived in the marina,
You would think it would be a disadvantage.
Yeah, everybody told me that actually. Everybody told me, yes, you're never gonna find a boat. Sailors don't love dogs, they hate dogs. You're never gonna find anyone. Mm-hmm. And I didn't wait 3 days. I found in 3 days. Mm-hmm. All the others was waiting like 2 months, sometimes 3 months. I found the most amazing catamaran, like the guy's built himself for 5 years, the catamaran. Mm-hmm. It's a completely custom catamaran. Mm-hmm. It was going 18 knots speed. Whoa. At some points. It was crazy.
Whoa,
it was amazing.
Catamaran.
Yeah, I have some photos I'll show you later.
And you came to Martinique or Guadeloupe?
We are in Guadeloupe, Saint-François.
What's the name of catamaran?
Henri Calvin.
Maybe no, we don't know. Because we spend a lot of time in French territories,
yeah, you can
in French Outremer.
It's a big yellow catamaran, completely different of others. You're never gonna find the same.
Maybe we never saw it because we've been in Guadeloupe and in Martinique. We spent, I don't know,
something like this
in total, like a lot of time. So we know probably almost everybody who's sailing in the Caribbean. At least we saw it. Okay, and what had happened after?
During the Atlantic, we took like 3 and 6 days. We were thinking to do it in 14 days, but we had some problem on the water, no wind, no water. But at the end, we arrived in Guadeloupe, and I stayed there a bit, like maybe 2 months. Uh-huh. And I found another boat from Le Gosier, Le Port du Gosier, to Honduras.
Ah, okay. Like that's strange way.
Actually, it was kind of a private boat, but it's like a cargo on sale. I think I'm sure you read about. It's like it was a German boat, Aventure, who had huge 44 meters long, and it was going to America to take coffee and rum, and bring that back to Germany. Only sailing, so no motor.
So like an old style, a trade wind.
All the boat was like a pirate ship, you know, like a lot of ropes everywhere. To take the main sail, we was like 10 guys pulling ropes.
Whoa,
it was
this
amazing.
Is one of these
things. It was super cool. 15 days I passed this on the Caribbean Sea, and they dropped me in Honduras. Mm-hmm. Well, normally, it's like kind of, you know, like a scholar boat.
Huge. Nice. That's a cool story.
Yeah.
And from Honduras?
From Honduras, they dropped me there. I arrived in Honduras with maybe two euros.
Uh-huh.
And
this is the new story.
That's back in the land, you know. So there, I wasn't supposed to take another boat or anything. I had to take a choice if I go to the north, Guatemala, Belize, Mexico, or go south, Nicaragua, Costa Rica, Panama, etc.
Uh-huh.
And at that moment, I didn't know, so I didn't want to get blocked by the US border, so I decided to go south. I didn't want to make a buckle and come back, so I just decided to travel Honduras, hitchhiking.
But it's a beautiful place because it isn't just all that areas are amazing.
It's beautiful. Honduras is beautiful. It's kind of
but all Central America is very beautiful.
Every country, every place is beautiful.
Do you speak Spanish?
I learned Spanish. I learned Spanish there, actually, in Honduras.
Uh-huh.
I didn't know so much before, but... Puedo hablar ahora.
Yo hablo español un poco también.
No, I don't have such good level, because I learned also, you know, Spanish I didn't learn in school. I learned, like, with the street people, like, mostly with the people.
Where we stop?
I think...
Honduras.
Yes.
In Honduras, I just arrived there, they dropped me, and I had 2 euros with me, so... I didn't speak a word of Spanish at that moment. And miraculously, I think I'm a very lucky guy in my travel. You know, I had so much moment where I was very bad and some people just come, show up and save me from that situation. But that moment was incredible because I was just like, I came to Honduras without vaccine to my dogs. So the douana was keeping my dog in the thing. I didn't know how the fuck I'm gonna do to take back my dog.
Yeah, because you need just to pay something.
Yeah, I need to pay. They was asking me like $100 to get back my dog, you know.
Mm.
And I was so fucked up. I had to do 2 euros. I was start to making a plan to how to get into the douanas and steal my dog and escape.
My God.
But it was crazy. At some moment, I was so desperate that I asked to ask my family because I didn't have any money. I didn't want to lose my dog, so the worst situation.
Yeah, because
I asked,
it's a family.
So I just went to the bank, and I was waiting in the queue. and one old woman, like maybe 70 years old, 75, come at me like, hey, you're not from here. And she talked to me in English. At the moment, I knew how to speak a bit of English. Hey, Olga. She's like Honduran. She worked in the United States and she come back to retreat in Honduras. Hey, you're not from here. Where are you from? And she started to talk to me. She saw that I was lost, you know, kind of desperate also, I don't know. And I just told her, yeah, I just arrived yesterday. I had some problems with my dog. I'm gonna find a solution. And I tell her the story about my dog and she told me, hey, okay, look, I have a farm, a horse farm, and you can come with me to my farm. You help me walk like a month. You take care of the horses, you clean the horse shit, and in change, but we took the dog now and she paid for the vaccine fees. And so I accept. I didn't went to the bank, I just accept and we took the dog. I was so happy. I jump on back of her truck and we drive 1 hour outside of her.
It's a cool story.
And we went to this little farm, you know, and it was like a horde of dogs. Like there was like 60, 70 dogs. It was bigger.
Oh,
it's a big house, you know.
You get right into her heart, into her heart, you know. It was right there.
It was such a warm heart, you know. She was taking street dogs who get abandoned in Honduras. It's like kind of a little poor country, so
yeah.
It's a lot of poverty, and the dogs, like, they just die in the street. So yes. she was taking care of dogs. She had like three horses.
Awesome.
Yeah, and she just received me. I put my tent in outside of her villa. Mm-hmm. I was sleeping in my tent. And every day I was working for her, and we become good friends.
Of course,
yes.
Olga. Hi, Olga, if you see me.
Such a lovely story.
Yeah,
I mean,
very lovely
such
story.
Such people, such, you know, so, brings you, like, the life just better having, you know.
I think I'm a very lucky guy. At some point, I never had such a problem. I think that was the biggest problem I had on my travel, when I almost lost my dog, but...
No, it's so scary when it is. You could not find a solution. Mm-hmm. No, that's a horrible story. When you just it's so close and so far, you know.
Yeah. So after that, after the month, she asked me to stay 1 month more. In change, I get a little bit of money, so I keep working there, taking care of horses. We are just next to the beach, so we was taking the horses on the sea, on the water, until the legs line. And we was, because they was half wild, they wasn't trained to be too much close of human.
Uh-huh.
So we just put them in the water until the legs, and we were jumping on the horses and breaking on the water. So, so cool. And you know, why in the water? Because if you just get kicked out, you just fall in the water,
yes,
you know?
Yes, yes.
And like every week we were doing this with the horses to train them. So, so, so good memories. Mm. After that, I get some money, she let me go, and I continue hitchhiking in Honduras. San Pedro de Sula, I sleep there in one night, in a garage, like a mechanic store. I didn't know where to sleep, so I just went to this mechanic's shop. I asked the guy, hey, can I just sleep there for tonight? Because San Pedro de Sula is the most dangerous city in all Latin America, so I didn't want to sleep in the street with my tent.
Better not to do
it. So yeah. I found this place and I slept there, I make friends. I learned Spanish at that moment, because in the 2 months I was with Olga, she take every day sometimes to teach me. And what I was saying is the rest of the Spanish I learned in the street with street people. So my Spanish is kind of bad, you know, like a bit like gangster. Yeah, freestyle. Chucha de tu madre que vamos a hacer. So I learned like this. I didn't have so much scholar.
It's a real
lesson.
One. Huh? Real knowledge.
It's super cool. It's super cool. That's Spanish, because when you go in the streets and you talk with people, they don't see like just a student of Spanish. You speak like them, you know. A wave of sound. You just.
It opens some doors.
It's so cool.
Like,
yeah, it's open doors.
I meet so many street people. It's so cool. It's so. Yeah. It's good.
I will be on the camera because people have to see the true traveler.
True traveler.
Yeah.
Tell me, please, about your trip in South America.
Okay, so after Honduras, I come down all Nicaragua, Costa Rica, Panama. I was working in Panama as a crew for boat for charter. After that, at some point,
I was able to go to Cartagena, Colombia.
Uh-huh.
And my idea was to actually at that moment I still wanted to cross Pacific. So I was kind of looking for boats maybe to cross Pacific, and I was expecting maybe on the west coast of South America at some point I will find a port where there are some sailing boats and they're going to take me for cross Pacific to Polynesia, Indonesia, Australia. So yeah, I just start to hitchhike, enjoy my life in Colombia, hitchhike all the way through Colombia, Ecuador, Peru, all the west coast, Bolivia, Chile. I went to the southest part I could be. I went to Patagonia until Perito Moreno. It's like an iceberg over there. Not an iceberg, but like
but
ice.
But it is just, what's the name of it? South.
Patagonia?
Ushuaia. Ushuaia.
No, I didn't want to tell Ushuaia because at the moment it was winter. So I was in Chile, traveling with my backpack behind trucks. And I wanted to go the southest as possible, but I was still in tents, you know, I was sleeping in tents. I had two sleeping bags, I had a small mattress.
But it's really cold.
Yeah, it was very cold. So the dog was sleeping inside the sleeping bag to keep me warm.
Le papel!
And we was going down the southest as possible, and at some point it was so cold we were just in the tents closing everything, sleeping with all the clothes just to keep warm, you know. And at that time we realized, oh, we cannot go more south, we have to go north again. We cannot go to Ushuaia. We would like to see the penguin, we want to go to
like equator.
So we wanted to see some ice. We saw some ice, it was beautiful. Patagonia, you know. The way also of traveling in South America is different than hitchhiking, because in South America you don't travel, hey, can you take me to the next city? No, you don't do that. In South America it's a different thing. I learned it when I was in Colombia. It's called, they call it planchonar. Planchonar, it's a way of traveling, somehow hitchhiking, but with trucks. Okay, so you have a big trucks on the road, usually big trucks with a platform behind. And what you do, you just wait until it slows down.
Jump.
You run behind, you run like a crazy. So I was like this, with my dog, with my 25 kilos backpack, running behind the truck, grabbing the truck, climbing on the truck, and just staying on the top. So I was on the roof of the truck. But the problem with this is sometimes you don't know where it's going, because you don't ask the driver. So you don't know if he's just going to turn around and go in complete fucking other direction. And the truck drivers, usually, they drive all night. They drive like 8 hours. So you cannot just jump out of the truck if it's going the wrong way. So you have to, it's kind of chance, you know, somehow. Mm-hmm. So we were doing like this in almost all South America. Climbing truck, but it's amazing because, you know, you just, on the top of a car, a truck who is moving is driving like crazy, you know, how is it driving in South America? And you just, the first time I was there, I was so scared to fall off the truck. I just, because it was like night, so the truck was supposed to drive all night and the morning arrive to the place, maybe. So I knew that I had to sleep on the truck, so I had to put my sleeping bag, and I put my sleeping bag, my bag, I attached the dog to my bag, I attached myself to the truck,
yes,
with ropes, because I was so afraid, I was so scared to just fall, you know?
Of course.
And it was so cool, you know, driving all night, passing by the small pueblo, and just looking at all the stars, and it was so, so cool. And after that, I love it so much that I did all the South America like this. Sometimes with other cars also, but this is the way, best way to travel South America, seriously. It's amazing, because the first time you're always super scared. You're always super scared to fall off the truck. But at some point, after 5, 6, 7 trucks, you just get used so much that it's your apartment, you know, you just walk on the truck, you go to pee behind. Sometimes you start to talk with the diver, he isn't supposed to know that you are here, but sometimes they just know and they just don't care because they don't want problem, you know. So yeah, most of travel in South America have been like this. So all the Peru, desert of Peru, Ecuador mountain, la Sierra, how you call it? Los Andinos, the mountain. I passed through all of that on the behind of the truck, so I had the best view on everything. That was so, so great.
How much time did you spend in
I have no
South
idea.
America?
No idea.
Like a year, 2 years?
2 years maybe, or
three, I don't know. Really, I can check my phone and
find
the date.
No, it doesn't matter. But I mean just like generally, yeah. Like even feeling, like 2 years.
So yeah, at some point in South America, in Chile, it was too cold, so we decided to go back. Not by the west coast, but we decided to go through the jungle by
in the middle.
Argentina. We travel all through Argentina, Paraguay, Paraguay. We tried to follow the river, Paraguay River. We check on the way. That was cool. Also, just fisherman boats, small fisherman boats was carrying us, me, the dogs, the backpack, and we had no money at that time. Because in South America, I was doing something different. I wasn't playing music because it didn't work. Because a lot of people play music in the streets, and I was very bad. You know, I still had the ukulele. And I found it. You were talking me about marketing before. It's crazy because I don't know why I found the ideas like, I have so much photo. I like to share my photos with people. I'm gonna print them. I print like 50 photos, mm-hmm. My best photos, mm-hmm. And I just sit in a bench. I put all the photo on the floor, mm-hmm. And I just wait. And just people just show up. They look at the photo. Sometimes they just leave, they continue the way. People from every day, you know, they just come back from walking, they just go back to walking, and they just stop and look at the photo, and when they start to ask a question, you know, I don't put any price or anything, you know, it's just photos on the floor. And people stop and look at the photo, hey, where is that? And yeah, I start to telling my story like I'm telling now, you know. People, it's one moment, it's 10 minutes where I tell my story, and people are just so happy to know something different, you know. It's like watching a video. And after they say, okay, keep it. So I just sell it for $1. So I was, they take the photos, they have a memory of me, a photo they really like. And with the photo, more than the photo, is the story who is behind, you know, because every story is crazy. Yes.
But you sell a story, you don't sell a photo.
And it's also good for me because like this, I can meet new people, I meet completely random people of every day, you know. They're doing the same thing every day, and for 10 minutes they have a different perspective of life, you know. They understand that you can travel all around the world. They understand that if you can do it, maybe they can do it. Mm-hmm. It's a complete...
And you're with dog, you know?
And yes, with the dog. And on the side, like, you know, I was me and the dog.
100 kilos heavy, in matter of everything, you know?
The dog, at that moment I made her a backpack, you know, to carry the food. So people was very interested to see the little dog with the guy with the backpack, and they say, hey, what you doing? Oh, what the fuck is the dog? And, you know, easily you make contacts with people and you start to talk, and it's great. I made a very good friend like this, mm-hmm. And I meet people from everywhere, from a rich man to the street guys. Mm-hmm. It's amazing how South America is, because like this you can really know, I think, a country. It's not by passing through touristical place. I didn't went to Machu Picchu because it was so expensive for me, but at Peru I meet so many people and it's so great. I think really traveling in a country is not about knowing
place. It's about
talking
people.
With people. Yeah. It's about really knowing the people, how they live, their problem, their life, it's amazing. It's beautiful life. Oh, you know,
guys, I would like to remind you, it's very important to us to subscribe to our channel, to put like, because it is really inspiring us to make more videos.
They're so beautiful, dogs. Yes, you're beautiful.
But where was your boat all this time?
All this time, it was still in Panama. I didn't. The first time I passed in Panama, I just passed through. Mm-hmm. Like I walked with fastly on the. On other boats, but after that I went to Colombia, and I went all the back South America, traveling South America, Chile, Patagonia, etc. Mm-hmm. After I went all the way up Paraguay, Brazil. From Brazil I crossed the Amazonian River with some hitchhiking and ferry. And at some point I arrived to Leticia, I come back to Peru? No, Colombia, perhaps, I don't know. I think it was like Peru and Colombia by the jungle, pure jungle. And I arrived back in Colombia, and there I stayed to my friend's house. I made some friends there. Mm-hmm. And at some point, I wanted to go back to Panama, because I couldn't find any boat in South America to cross the Pacific. That was my plan. That was my first objective.
No,
but
from
I couldn't
that place
find.
Only
so I was
from
kind
Ecuador.
Of lost, you know. I was like kind of lost. I don't know where to go next. Mm-hmm. So I have to go somewhere, and I know maybe Panama. Panama is where Panama Canal pass. So maybe from there I can just. Find again, look for a boat, but I arrived at the last of my 5 years. When I started my travel, I wanted 5 years of traveling. Mm-hmm. And at that moment, it was like 4.5 years, and I arrived at the end. I arrived in front of a wall, so it was kind of...
what to do? Another half year out of
that why also I was very bad, and I'm a kind of depression, and I had to question all my life. Should I go back to France?
Mm-hmm.
Go to work in a factory?
Mm-hmm.
Or should I just continue the life I the life I love, you know? And it was important, really important for me to... I don't know, it was a big moment in my life.
Well, after Honduras, I traveled also to America, etc.
Ah.
I come back to Panama. And after the COVID, I was like, I passed the COVID in the Darien Gap. I don't know if you know.
Yeah, Darien.
Okay, Darien Gap, there's like a big lake, which is called the Lago Baiano. And in that lake, I was with a girl at that moment. We just, when we start to hear about the COVID, we just escaped there in the middle of the jungle. On the island, we stayed there all the first phase of the COVID. So no one around, just a few farmers. And we take a lot of food with us, a lot of water. And we squat that little island on the lake. And there was all the wood house, we just restored it. And we lived there like 3 months. And on that lake, actually it was a boat. It was the only sailing boat on the lake. It was this boat. And it was like completely abandoned. It was on an anchorage in some place attached to some tree. All fucked up, all the gel coat was green, the water was half on the boat, only rainwater.
So it was just abandoned and
it was
abandoned
for like I think it's like for 4 years it was abandoned, it was just like let to die. And I saw the boat at that moment, I didn't fuck to take it, but yeah. At that moment I was still with this girl, after she left, after I stayed like 1 month alone in the jungle. And I make kind of a depression, and I come back to France. I saw my mom again. It was super cool. She helped me a lot at that moment. And I work in Amazon. You know, Amazon, that shitty place where you work like a machine. Imagine from the jungle, a month, 3 months alone, you're going
God.
To the fucking city, Paris, and you go to work in a factory. I work 2 months. I just get crazy. I just get in fights with people around me. So at that point, I just get kicked out, and I had still the money of the job, and I had to take a decision because, you know, when I come back to France after my depression, my dog was still there in Panama. I let her to some farmers because I couldn't take her with me.
Yeah.
So I was in Paris. My dog was in Panama, and I didn't know if I can come back because what I'm gonna do if I come back? I will be lost. It was kind of a very rude moment in my life.
It's a hard time.
Yeah, it was a hard time.
I mean, emotionally.
My dog also was very bad. The farmer was taking care of her. They was doing the best, but she was very sad, so she lost all her hair. She was completely naked. Because of stress, you know, because she's used to stay all the time with me. So it was kind of hard. So at that moment, when they sent me that photo, I had like 3,000 bucks in my pocket. And I just booked the first flight in November, I think the 10th of November 2020. I booked a flight to...
like almost a year ago, like
almost.
Gonna be in 10 days.
I choose to go back to Panama to save my dog. I didn't want to let her die alone.
Mm-hmm.
It will be so bad, you know. And I just come back there and I was starting to make some plan how I'm gonna do with the dog, how I can bring her back to France.
Mm-hmm.
I had enough money to pay her papers because there's a lot of document administration
shit and stuff like this.
I was thinking to that, you know, at that moment. And when I arrived there, I was so happy to go back to the jungle, you know, like, fuck man, no noise, fish around, monkeys screaming. Such a paradise. And at that moment I was thinking, okay, let's start to make the project of making her documents to bring her back to France, take a flight, reserve a flight. And more I was thinking to France, more I was getting loco, like crazy. I didn't want to come back. I didn't want to come back to Amazon. I don't want to come back to this world with just like everything. It makes me frustrated, you know? I want to be free. I want really to be free. So I had to find another solution. I'm not gonna come back to France. There are these boats abandoned in the lake. I have just enough money to buy the boat. I have no idea if it's good, if the motor's working, if the boat I can... It was in the middle of the lake. I cannot go to the ocean with the lake, with the boat.
I
had to plan, I had to imagine how fuck I'm gonna pull the thing. It was such a big decision for me, you know? But for the dog,
I say no.
You need a home.
I'm gonna do it.
I need to make a home for my dog.
I have to do something. I'm not gonna die here. I'm not gonna let my dog die. I'm gonna do something. I want to do something. So what we do, we call the proprietor, the owner of the boat. Before that was a guy, GP, old teacher for me. And he told the price. We start to work on the boats.
It's price.
The boats, $2,000.
Uh-huh.
Cheap. $2,000, I had like maybe...
But cheap, 3, you know, cheap it is relatively. If you have that money, it is all your money you have. It's not a cheap, it is the money all you have.
What is good, what is good when you're traveling is that if you don't have money, you used to don't have money. So you know how to do when you don't have money. So I can use all my money, I don't care. If I zero, I know I'm gonna find some food. I know I'm gonna play some music in the street. I'm gonna sell some photos. I know it's gonna work, you know. So I wasn't afraid. I used all my money, fuck, in the boat, and I started to clean. No electricity, just a couple of farmers was living next by. Mm-hmm. I was helping them in the field, in the planting rice. Mm-hmm. In change, I was giving me food because I didn't have kitchen. Mm-hmm. So I was every day. Mm-hmm. Going to the house and mm-hmm. feed me, you get a good friend also. Mm-hmm. And all the rest of the day I was fixing my boat, fixing the motor. The motor, I spent like, I think, I don't know, maybe 2 weeks continuously just working on the motors, fixing, mm-hmm. fixing. I didn't know any shit about motors.
Yes,
I just checked YouTube.
Where did you find the spare parts?
The spare parts, alternator was fucked up. The
okay, alternator you can take it from a car.
But the starter was fucked up. The
it's also
the
possible for
a
car.
But if you don't have money, it's not possible to get spare parts. So
and
I was
like first time. With
yeah, I was just taking the thing out and I was fixing with glue, with epoxy, everything like a puzzle. But until it's broke, it's broke. I was so happy.
Of course,
I put that. I just turned the keys. You know, the moment you turn the keys,
yes.
and you just
jig, 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 jig,
2 weeks
jig.
Of fucking work, and boop, 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 boop.
Yes.
We were just so crazy with the dog. The dog even was happy. I don't know if she understood, but I was so so happy that the dog understood it, and the motor was working. That's the heart of the boat, you know. So without the motor, it would be $2,000 just lost in a piece of fibers on the lake. So when I fixed the motor, whoa. So at that moment, I was able to fix the motor. I can drive, so I could move. The boat was like, you know, to get to the place where the boat was, it was like 1 hour from the first little village mm-hmm. to go to there. Mm-hmm. From there, there was a little home, like farmer home, mm-hmm. was like 5 minutes. But all the rest is like, there are nothing around. They're pure jungle. So it was very hard for me to every day make like 1 hour if I had to go to the village. So I was very autonomous. I tried to prepare everything. And at that moment, I was able to move the boat. I could bring it closer to the village, you know. I bring it to the coast, close to the fisherman village.
So much faster, like you saved 2 hours a day. Yeah.
Before, you know, when I was in the islands, to get internet, I had to climb a mountain on the top of the mountain. Every time to get just a bit of internet, some signal, mm-hmm. I was going to the mountain. I was checking how to fix an alternator, how to fix a starter. I was recording everything on my phone.
Uh-huh.
And going back to my boat, checking at night. I didn't have light, so I was like just with my phone and tried to fix everything. And it was crazy. It was super crazy.
It's such an experience. I mean, you probably know the motor more than any other person in the world knows the motor.
What is good is when you start with nothing, is you know every screw of the boat. I know it's every part of little rust. I know
But from a lake, how did you take it out?
Okay, so after some points, I fixed the motors. I knew that I was ready to go to the sea. I had to start to planificate how I'm gonna take out the boat out of the lake. So first of all, I have to take down the mast because I cannot carry that on a truck.
Uh-huh.
So I went to a fucking coconut tree. I attached a rope on the coconut tree with a thing. I had to take it 2 times because the first time the coconut tree just fell on my boat. The mast just passed through the boat, almost make a hole on the fibers. And it was like 6 p.m. when it happened, you know. So all was fucked up. Like the mast was like teeth on the boat, and there was a huge fucking coconut tree on my boat, you know. So with all the leaves. So it happened like 6 p.m. It was starting to get night, and I needed to
I need to clean everything, you know, but I just went to sleep. I just, fuck the
But
situation.
You got a coconut. It's fine, at least.
I tell you, it wasn't the coconut tree. I said coconut tree, but...
At some points, it's better to leave it because it's like you're so tired and stressed.
Yeah,
and
yeah, you can make it much worse.
Actually, it wasn't a coconut tree. It was like another kind of tree, but very weak, and it just fell on my boat. But the morning, I just wake up with a machete, cutting everything. Take out of the shit of my boat, it break. I think you see a lot of holes on my boat. Is actually the tree who fall. So the next day I start to try again the process. I found another tree with a bigger mm-hmm. and with another stem with a ratchet. Tack 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 alone with a dog. Taking up the mast after taking down the mast. So every time I have to climb the little hill to. Ratchet, go down to my boat, adjust the mast, go back to the hill.
Big project.
Like
big project.
Yeah, that was cool. That was cool. I was very proud of myself after that because it's a good it's a big walk to take down a mast, you know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, we know we did it, but with the proper equipment, you know? Yeah. And we know how difficult it is. But without equipment, it's a nightmare.
I had like a little ratchet.
Yeah, yeah. I know, like a trick. Yeah, yeah, it is like for trucks, you know, for
yeah,
a toy,
to
yeah.
Stuff on top of food.
Yeah, or fix or just carry something, yeah.
So yeah, after I took down the mast, I had the mast on my boat, like down.
Yeah, all the long way.
Yeah, and I had to start to plan to rent a truck. I had to rent a truck, and I had to rent a crane. So I was looking like for 2 weeks, calling everybody to know if anyone know how the price is. They was asking $6,000 for everything.
Yeah.
They was asking $6,000. I couldn't find cheaper than 5,500, I think. And I was looking everywhere, and at some points, I had a friend of a friend. I told him, okay, look, I give you $100 if you find me the cheapest truck, the cheapest crane, and we're gonna do it with this. And so he called every friend he have, and in 2 days he found, okay, we have one truck, one crane. It's gonna cost $2,200.
Still a lot, huh?
But it's still a lot.
It's still a lot, but fortunately, actually, thanks to my brother, because he helped me a bit with this. He advanced me the money. Mm-hmm. I'm still paying him back, mm-hmm. and I was able to do that.
To
take. So the day we had to take out the boat, I was so fucked up, stressed. You know, like, oh man, it's a day. It's a big day because if one thing fucked up, everything fucked up,
yes.
And I lost all the money because there are no security, there are no guarantees. It's not like European, you know.
Yes, like, if
the fucking boat,
you, yeah?
If the fucking boat just fall on the side of the street in the middle of.
Like in many YouTube videos, you can watch to the
I will be dead. I would be dead. I will lose everything I have, and I will have debts and everything, you know. Tell me again.
Which place did you put it in the water, in the big water?
It happened the day we craned up the boat. We had the truck. We had to took it in two times because the truck wasn't close enough. So we dropped back the boat.
It's
on
not
the floor.
Enough, and you need to put it back. Come close. And,
So okay. At some point, we had a big problem because it took like 4 hours, and the crane wasn't able to take up the boat straight. So the boat was with a keel like this, and we had
tum.
No, not swinging, but just the fact that the keel is not normally you put a boat on the track
lift,
like this,
yeah, straight
on all the weight on the keel. But that problem was like the keel was this,
and
so all the weight was half on the keel, half on the hull, and it's
somewhere.
Like 5 tons. So, but we just put it like this. We put tires of cars under to try to armor to reduce the shocks, mm-hmm. and when the boat was on the truck with all the tires attached like hell, you know, everywhere. Mm-hmm. We just drive all the way, 150 kilometers, I think like 6 or 8 hours of from the middle of the jungle over there, Darien.
From the
all
middle,
the way
I mean
to Panama
the jungle
City.
Road, it's not the highway road where it's like...
Pass to Panama City, Colón, Puerto Belo. I was all the way, I was with the truck driver. I was praying, fuck. Hold it, don't fall, because the boat was faking like this, you know, at any time it can just collapse. And... Ooh, I cry when I arrive in the last hill, you know, of Puerto Lindo.
Uh-huh. Yes,
go to Puerto Lindo, on the top of the hill when I see the marina, I cry. I cried. I was so stressed all day and all that. Fuck, you're right. Fuck.
But why you decide not to put it in the Pacific side?
It was a big decision also, because I had the choice also to put it in Pacific. But, you know, the boat didn't have mast. All the boat was still kind of fucked. I wasn't ready. I'm a noob in sailing, you know. I need to learn a bit. And I wasn't ready. I know at some point I'm going to sail Pacific, but I know it's not my time yet. So I needed to go in a place where it will be easy for me to have time to get the knowledge, to get the experience, to be ready to cross Pacific. So I decided finally, even if it cost me much more, to bring it to the Caribbean than to the Pacific. Yes, they dropped me here with a travel lift, and with the travel lift, they put me on the water.
Over and here in the marina?
In the marina, yeah. I arrived here without knowing so much about the marina. I had some experience with other boats here before, because I worked with another catamaran to make him charter. I learned some bias of sailing also, and we were doing like charter to San Blas, Cartagena, coming back. So there I get my base of experience. With a captain who's super cool, maybe you know him, GP?
That guy with the tattoo?
Yeah, he's tattoo everywhere.
Yes, we know him.
He was my teacher for like a few, for a long time actually. And my captain and my teacher, and I learned a lot. It's very hard to work with him, but I think he's a very good guy. And I believe he teach me a lot.
I know about, him. Mostly. Do you remember who is it? Yeah, it's a captain from a marina.
A lot of experience of salving boats. Like fucked up boats, mud everywhere, everything breaking.
So have experience, you save your own boat.
Yeah, that's why. That's how, actually. I wouldn't buy the boat if I didn't have the experience with him, you know? Because if the boat was so fucked up, I would be afraid at the start. But because I worked with him, it gave me confidence, because I already saw boats fucked up like this. And I saw how to fix them. That's how I learned.
Confident how to do it, and exactly that you will manage the problems. Okay.
Also, we meet a lot of people, or the sailors, stuff like this, a very like kind of pirate world. And it was fun, because I was a blue, you know, the beginner on the sea. And they was all making fun of me because I'm a beginner. And I don't know so much about boat, but I'm learning a lot, I'm doing everything. And as I say, you never become a marinero. I told them, you no soy marinero, yo soy pirata. That's my...
Я не свой маринеро, свой капитан. Он поко диференте. Okay, so, yeah. And what is your general plan for a closest future and not closest future, just long terms?
Well, like closest future is make money.
It's always like this.
Yeah, but my closest future right now is I try to make enough money. To finish my boat, try to make it good enough to sail, and to have enough in the side in case of if I need it, you know. That's a important close future. In the middle length future, I think I'm gonna go sailing to Boca del Toro, try to make a charter there, take some people, make them pay $50 per day, you know, and bring them to island, and make some money like this. The longest future is try to have enough money to pass the Canal of Panama. I want to pass the Canal of Panama, and it's not that much money, but like I'm working, it's kind of a long-term future.
So, super small boat.
When I will be ready, I think I have a longest future is to cross Pacific on single-handed.
Do some add-ons like solar panel, probably.
Sure. It still needs a lot of stuff, but
in a boat, it's never enough.
I think it's pretty good right now. It's enough to survive. It's enough to
autopilot or something.
Yeah, I don't have autopilot. I have one, but I'm still fixing it, and it's like kind of electronics. And now I'm in the phase I have to try it to see if it's work. It's not I teach the dog how to drive and she's gonna keep the wheel and it can walk. But yes, that's my longest future. I want to cross Pacific single-handed.
Okay.
Single-handed and the dog. Don't want Fossili to be like a help, because I think the nature of my travel is to do by myself. Somehow, if I start to make a YouTube page or if I make an Instagram page,
I don't want to people so much invest in my project, because my project is to be alone somehow, it by myself.
It's another thing.
No, the travel have this kind of nature, and my way of traveling is to travel with a minimum. If I start to have some, let's say, easy money on the side, I would completely do differently.
You're afraid that it spoil you.
For example, if I have no money at all, I need to eat. What I do, I go to the first restaurant and I, hey, can I wash your plates? Just give me a plate of food and I'm gonna wash your plates. And you know, this thing I wouldn't do if I had money on the side. And that's how,
because
okay. You meet the people, you start to talk with them, you start to hear the story, and it's a completely different thing. If I had money on the side, somehow, it wouldn't happen, you know. I meet such amazing people on my travel.
Yes, but you had a story with your dog.
Yeah, sure. Sometimes life can be like surprise you, and you can have some problems. You need that money on the side, okay. But if you have this money on the side, somehow you're gonna take the easiest way to resolve that problem. You're just gonna use the money, but it's an easier way. But maybe you have other different ways that can bring you somewhere else. And that's what I like also, you know, when you don't have so much money.
You are more flexible with your decision.
More free.
Yes, I agree.
For 5 years, I had serious problems sometimes. I had very bad problem, I had a bad situation. I know in security, if I have very big trouble, I will ask help. I know I wouldn't die just like a piece of shit. I would find a solution, but it never happened to me, so. Mm-hmm. I had problems, but I always resolved them. Mm-hmm.
But
I think it's more human approach. I feel like it's more natural,
you know,
way of
traveling. When we meet people like you, you also teach us about that is not only one way which we are going.
Our tunnel vision.
Yeah, we have also tunnel vision. So we just look there, but it's a more ways, and it is a wider. So it is a cool and. Guys, let's go and look.
Visit La Francesca.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, just go down and see.
Oh,
sorry. So, the cockpit, everything, the table, I made the roof is like 2 showers.
You have a hard top.
I made a hard top out. Actually, it was a Bimini before, but it was completely destroyed. So I actually took 2 inside shower of a catamaran I was working on, and I put them together, I put some fibers, and I actually make a good roof. I wanted something out, because usually the Bimini is so expensive to make, and
yes,
and this is
right.
I can just punch it. Before I had just a piece of tissue on it, and I was just passing a hand, and it was a big hole, you know.
Yeah, we
so,
know, because
so it's so cool. Hard top.
Do you know what's the brand of your boat?
Charlie's Morgan.
Okay, which year is it?
74. You have like 40 years. Okay, so my favorite part of the boat, the kitchen. So before it was a complete mess here. I tried to rebuild everything with teak. I found some very cheap teak in the jungle where I was there before. Some guys who are cutting teak, so I booked a lot of wood stripes, and it's like a Lego, you know, you just put them together. You don't need to be so much good about woodworking to make this. And yeah, I tried to make a spacious kitchen. I found this kitchen, actually, this cooking stove is like made out of trash. It's a lot of different parts of different ovens that I fixed together. I found it in the trash of Marina. And at the end, I found the perfect shape. It's so cool, because I have to fire. Well, the ovens don't work yet, but soon I'm gonna be able to make some bread. And yeah, since I don't have fridge.
But you have a fridge with an ice.
Actually, I don't have fridge. I have a cooler, but what I'm doing with this cooler actually is I put salt inside. I put big salt, and I can put a lot of vegetables, dry things to keep them dry, you know, salt absorbs the humidity.
Yeah,
I make a system, a little system, you know, it's simple, but it's just a pile of salt, humidity attracted by the salt, and it's dropped inside the cube. So it's reduced the humidity as a maximum, and it can make me keep the vegetables like 2 weeks more. It's super cool.
I'm gonna make on the hot top actually kind of place a platform to dry stuff. Like if I get some mushrooms, if I get some fruits that start to get bad, I just cut them and I let them dry in the roof on the roof. And after I can keep them in the little bottles here. Some jars. I try to make some cheese. I have some dry mushrooms. Sometimes I make some garlic mixed with spices, oil.
And you have here is just a working area.
It's my office. It's now my workshop. Well, before it was like a kind of bed here. So I rebuilt everything. I took out the bed. I built this to make me a big how you say?
Working area.
Keeping stuff mostly to
lockers.
I can still open it and make another bed here. This I can take out everything and put a bed here. I can receive 2-3 people. Working shop, because it's I make a lot of I really like to make experience and constructing things, try to fix stuff. So I needed a big space and it's perfect. I really love this table. Here I try to grow some basic legumes. Well, this is just some plants. I still need to experience more, but I want to try at some point to make grow some garlic, just a tea to eat it with sauces, maybe tomatoes. We will see.
And show your
Front cabin. The front cabin you can go. It's very small, but it's enough for 2 people. It's still on the process, working on it. But
what is in the front? Is it chain locker?
Yeah, chain locker.
And the toilet?
Yeah.
It's a manual toilet with a thing which is it has a pump. You can just put in that stick and just bring the water from it.
Yeah, that's my comfort zone.
How many feet do you have in your boat?
I think it's 30 feet, 30.2 feet, so it's like a little bit less than 10. Yeah.
What is it?
It's all the work I'm doing all the time. Like I try to make list of what I have to do and I just take off the paper, do a moment, some drawing, some projects, some nice photos. The first boat I was. So it makes me remember Izzy and me on the first seasick. So yeah, this is I put it in a relaxed place, like I can just sleep here also, no problem. That's my office. I built all the electricity on the boat, so I make a...
It's like a chart table.
Yeah, chart table, but all rebuilt. There was nothing here, there was a bed. So this is, I take it from an abandoned boat over there on the reef. Uh-huh. So I rebuilt my boat with a lot of things I found and so a lot of things people give to me also.
What is it?
It's a storage. Like I have 400 bucks of food. Like a reserve of food and to gain a maximum space.
It is a storage under the stern locker.
Yep.
And from that side is it the same, yeah?
Like a daily food, let's say storage for daily food. I want to show you this. I love this. I put all the spices in order. That's my spices. And also
you have a lot of spices here. Eh?
All the basic food I use. Storage for pots and storage for treasure. So I like to organize the boats a bit to be simple and try to optimize everything, easy access, to be able to cook everything fast, to be able to have everyone his own space, so I don't disorganize myself, you know. So yeah, it's I really like this boat because I made it. So I made it myself and I made it in the way that I like to be. So welcome to my boat. So it's a bit tricky way, but okay, my sailboat. So the mainsail fixed together. I broke it recently, but I need to buy a new one or try to fix this one. It's a small sail, but I hear that boat for the crash test we did is quite a kind of fast and take a very good wind.
Did you have any accident on just touch ground or something?
No, never. We broke the mainsail, nothing else. I tried the second test to push the boat as its maximum and well, the sail broke. But yeah, it's something I can fix. All that is fixed. I made this one also. It's all manual. So all the thing was fucked up. I just rebuilt it, the tambour for the Genoa. Still a lot of work to do, but I don't have right now the money to fix everything, so I just do by little for what I can do. And yeah, it's still good for sailing. We try sailing. We went to Isla Grande. I have anchor. This is everything I made by myself. You know, it's kind of that's technical part. Oh, yeah, it's PVC. Plexiglass. But yeah, it's working, so it's the most important, right?
Yeah. Because it is you have a Dyneema line, which is full and is it full? Nice.
A small boat, but with a big heart.
Okay, guys. I think that's amazing experience. I even cannot say any word about how cool is it, because it's a totally different. And if you want to follow that cool story, subscribe to all social media you see now on the screen, and in the video description also please find all social media links, and just follow that cool story. And I hope to see you in the closest future in Pacific, because we are going there.
I'm very happy to have you here. And if I can do it, everybody can do it, and just follow your life and follow the flow. Life is beautiful, and it shouldn't be a pain. Life is beautiful and shouldn't be a pain. And adventures is great, and everyone who love to can come in my boat at any moment. I would love to receive people and just change a bit of their life, and maybe just pass 1 week here with me, and maybe it's gonna give another perspective on your life. And
life isn't
an adventure, is nothing. It's very important.
I forgot to say about following that beautiful
The most important dog. Is this chair.
The most real traveler, the real dog. Traveler. Okay, guys, see you soon. Bye bye.